inside the UCLA Hall of Fame room, and women's basketball takes up an entire corner. It's Oregon against number 10 UCLA. The Bruins are 14-1 overall, 4-0 in conference. Oregon is 11-5, but only 2-3 in the Pac-10. Let's take a look at the visitors from Eugene. Coming off that loss Thursday at USC, four juniors and the senior is Victoria Kenyon. Kenyon had 15 points at SC. They all came on three-point shots. Paul Westhead is the head coach in his second season. What can you say about the legend? He's the best offensive mind in the women's game, and Oregon reflects that, averaging 85 points a game, number one in the conference. UCLA, one sophomore, Ingefa, one junior, Dixon, and then three seniors in the starting lineup, Campbell and Morris, and then a change, Nina Earle is going to get the nod today over Markel Walker. Nikki Caldwell, in her third season in Westwood. Paul Westhead is all about offense. Nikki Caldwell builds from the back. She starts with defense. UCLA allows just 53 points a game, number one in the conference. She's smiling now, but at practice yesterday, she was not happy, Mary. She had her team in a film session for 90 minutes, and then when they came on the floor, no basketballs. They stayed in the rack. Everybody was running.
Yeah, she really wants her team to get after it, and a lot of the attention was focused on the guard play. She wants more intensity, taking care of the basketball, just do a better overall job, and she wants practice to be harder than games. They had a pretty tough practice yesterday. They better be ready to go because this Oregon team's going to run them, Lisa.
They're going to run, and it's going to be exciting to see how their defense affects Oregon's offense, if it's affected at all.
UCLA is number 10 in the nation for the first time since 2001. UCLA's only loss came to LSU, a couple of points here at home, a game they probably could have won. And they beat Notre Dame on the road. Notre Dame was ranked 12th in the nation when UCLA beat them in South Bend. Bruins in the white, Ducks in the black and green. And the first look of the game from outside is Derexia Morris, who also averages 11 points a game, just like Jasmine Dixon.
And going back to that top 10, UCLA moved up from 12 to 10 this week based on that performance against USC.
And Jackson inside misses. Jasmine Dixon wrestles the rebound away. It's a jump ball.
And you can see right there with Nia Jackson just really going all the way to the basket. The key for UCLA is going to be to try to slow her down, keep a player in front of her, and Mary, if nothing else, come up with the rebound like they just did.
It's going to be very challenging because by the time she gets to half court, she already has a head of steam. So you better be back and in position or she'll go right by you.
Nia Jackson with the ball has been outstanding for Oregon all season long, but especially the last couple of weeks. She's had 20-point games, three in a row. For Oregon coming in, it's not only a great defensive team in UCLA, it's a top 10 team, and historically they have not done well. They've lost 17 straight times to teams ranked in the nation's top 10. In fact, the last road win over any team, even in the top 25 for Oregon, came back in January of 2000. And Terexia Morris is 2 for 2.
And Jim, you know, I think what I talked to Coach Paul Westhead in regards to their style, their philosophy of getting this ball up as quickly as they can, scoring as fast as they can. And I asked, do you adjust to other teams? And he said, no, the only thing they adjust is their defense. So that could be, you know, Mary, that could play a part in when they're playing these top 10 teams. If you're not going to adjust the way you run your offense, you may run into some problems.
He is just thoroughly committed to his style. Won a championship with the Phoenix Mercury doing it, and that's just the way it's going to be up in Eugene. It's exciting to watch, no doubt about that.
That's Dixon inside.
And it is safe to say that this UCLA team has come out like they got lit up in the locker room, like, let's get out there, a little fire and brimstone from Coach Nikki Caldwell.
We'll see if Westhead makes any adjustments here early in this game. When you talk to Paul Westhead about his team, he says, look, we play offense, that's what we do. We're just going to run and try to outscore you. Morris misses her first shot of the day. And here comes Oregon on the run. It'll be like this all day long. Jackson. Kick it back to the top. Amanda Johnson, who came in as the leading scorer in the Pac-10.
That was a nice defensive effort right there by Nina Earle, getting in front of Johnson, really making sure that Jackson was cut off. Even though she got all the way to the paint, she was still right there in front of her and forcing them into a back shot.
And as we talked in the open about Amanda Johnson trailing in transition, how dynamic she can be. We saw her take the three. She will knock that down with great regularity.
And most teams, you think, hey, set it up, run the offense. No, not Oregon. They play very well when it's almost like scrambled offense. They get the ball outside to any of their shooters. Everybody has the green ball.
Spin there and a push off on Victoria Kenyon.
So far, it's really been played at UCLA style. It's forcing turnovers, travels. Dorina Campbell just stayed in front. Exactly what you said. Just keep a body between them, keep retreating, and do the best you can not to let them get to the rim.
For UCLA, no team has scored more than 67 points in regulation this year. UCLA's goal in this game is to keep Oregon down to about 50 or maybe even 60 points. UCLA doesn't score a lot either.
I saw UCLA work long and hard against that full court defense. Did a nice job there.
That's Dorina Campbell from the corner. So Campbell and Morris both look good from outside early. And UCLA, not a good outside shooting team. They don't even shoot a lot of threes.
Full court pressure by UCLA. They're going to mix and match. We're going to see. Full court.
See how quickly Oregon gets it up, usually about 8 seconds, as Lisa told you in our open.
But the good thing that UCLA is doing is really controlling the tempo. Where they will go wrong is trying to play the same tempo as the Oregon Ducks. They're used to playing that fast offense, but as you saw right there, pass thrown out of bounds. UCLA is really going to have to control the tempo on offense and slow down.
But Lisa, as a player, how do you avoid that temptation? Because when you look up court and you see you have numbers, you want to go.
You do, but that's not going to be to UCLA's advantage. Even here, I would slow it down. As you see, Nikki Caldwell on the side, slow it down, run a play. And if they can continue to control this tempo, this game will be more to their advantage.
South Direction Morris with the ball in the backcourt. She's a senior. She's trained to look at her coach and said, let's wait. It's not our game. Half court is our game. Campbell just hit from there. Pump fake, up and under, and she fouled.
Part of the emphasis in practice yesterday as we watched it, you guys, was simply take care of the basketball. 20 turnovers against Oregon State, and the Beavers were able to turn that into 3 points. They scored more points off turnovers than UCLA did, and to me, that's just an amazing statistic.
Well, when you look at Oregon State, they're 0-5 in the Pac-10. Do you think that maybe UCLA was overlooking them? Because sometimes it comes down to where you feel like your opponent not as good, and I think they just played a sloppy game.
Yeah, UCLA has a lot on their plate right now. Not only Oregon here, one of the highest scoring teams in the country, but Thursday they go up to the Bay Area to play Stanford.
Ooh, I'm loving it. Because Stanford is the rule. That's your mark to understand exactly where you are. And for UCLA to be ranked 10th in the nation, to go up against Stanford, who's amazing at home, College Pavilion, no joke. I played there many times and left pretty sad. So it's going to be a tough game for UCLA. But if they can stick to their defense and really conjure up enough offense, it'll be a great game.
Oregon couldn't even get the shot off. Off by UCLA. Morris. The shots have gotten descendingly worse, shorter and shorter.
Now, I'm wondering if all that running from yesterday is going to play a part in this game when it comes to their shots. UCLA already, like you said, not a good three-point shooting team, so they're going to shoot 15 and 17-footers, and they're coming up short already.
Oregon's going to stick with their philosophy. They're going to give up a lot of those perimeter shots, and so if he makes them early, hey, that's just great, but they just are going to count on UCLA cooling down and getting back to their number, what their average is.
UCLA began their practice yesterday by coming out, lining up on the sideline, and running what they call 17s, which is back and forth, touching each sideline 17 times with a one-minute clock running. If you don't make it, just get on the line and do it again.
That was Amanda Johnson on the offensive rebound, staying inside, and she's the Oregon's best rebounder, leading the Pac-10 with 8.4 a game.
Johnson's got 4 points. Campbell's hit twice. So Morris has a couple looks outside. So does Campbell. Campbell's got 5.
There's a nice pace to UCLA's offense. Take what the defense gives you. They're giving you the 15-footer. Hey, don't put it on the floor and try to force it inside. You know, off the dribble drive. Just take what they give you. They're shooting the ball really quite well.
Skip pass. Holiday going hard to the rack.
That was a nice move by Holiday. She saw that Jasmine Dixon was out of play. She took the baseline move. Nice off the glass.
There's UCLA in transition. Morris, 4-footer. Off the front iron, see Oregon baits you into playing a little bit quicker than you want to. They didn't set their offense. Now coming in, all the talk was about UCLA's defense and Oregon's offense. Oregon had averaged 85 a game, but so far today, the high scoring team, the UCLA Bruins. Last meeting between these teams was February 27th of last year at MacArthur Court, the last time the Bruins played at Old Mac Court. Bruins rallied from a 16-point deficit in the second half to win it 91-75. Jasmine Dixon, 31 points and 20 rebounds. Both of those were career highs. Mary, she rescued the Bruins that day. They were in a lot of trouble.
It was just sensational in the second half. End-to-end action by Jasmine Dixon. And that's the level of play that Nikki Caldwell is really looking for, a level of consistency. She can bring those kind of numbers all the time, and it's ebbed and flowed a little bit so far this season.
And as a post player, I'm totally impressed with Jasmine Dixon. At 6 foot, the way that she was able to take it, especially to Carly LaPlante from USC, who's 6'5", she has no fear. She's able to beat players, whether they're taller. She can then step out and knock down that 17-foot jump shot. I'm a big fan of Jasmine Dixon. Right there, all on cue, right?
Jasmine Dixon for UCLA, and the Bruins out to a 13-6 lead. Inside, Pauley Pavilion, Jim Watson, Lisa Leslie, Mary Murphy. UCLA is number 10 in the country. They're undefeated in conference and 14-1.
And shooting 60% from the floor at this juncture.
Oregon is 2-3 in conference, having lost to USC on Thursday night. But Oregon is also 11-5 overall on the year and averaging 85 points a game. UCLA defense against the Oregon offense. Gamble, is it two in a row? Up to short. Pulled down by Fallen. Ariel Thomas, cross court, gives it up late. Canepa got pushed, but they call the walk.
So defensively, you see the strategy by UCLA. They're clogging it up down at the other end. The rebounder gets the ball. They've got a couple people on it. It gets outlet. There's somebody at midcourt helping to slow Jackson down, and the break just never really unfolded.
And that's a nice job. But when you look at Oregon's defense, what they're doing is really packing in the paint, making UCLA shoot from the outside, which we already told you is not their best part of their game. But if they're patient, they may be able to get inside and get some, you know, more higher percentage shots.
Morris backs it out to set the offense. Rexy Morris, the senior, leads the Bruins really at both ends. Open look for Dixon. Dixon! Left alone. How does the defense get that loss? She's got six.
I'm so worried about her in the paint that they're going to leave Jasmine Dixon alone until she knocks down two or three of those.
I think she's got two of those already.
You go with the scouting report and then maybe you start making some changes. But Paul Westhead's been around a long time and he has patience with the game plan.
Paul Westhead, his second season in Eugene, and you can see that Dixon popped out on that high ball screen and nobody went with her.
No defense on the outside, and I think Oregon's going to have to start to extend their defense, Mary. They are going to have to move out further. Otherwise, UCLA, and they may not be great jump shooters, but without defense, I'm sure they can knock down some shots out there.
And they feel to be in great rhythm. They get the ball, and they're just feeling the pace, and the shots are flowing so far.
Oregon having trouble just getting off shots. Six turnovers for the Ducks, taken away by Jackson.
About Oregon, they're like a faucet. They can turn this thing on and you'll forget about the first 7 minutes.
Kenya to Canepa, and she was held by Dixon.
That's a big body for Jasmine Dixon down low to try to do something with. And the big girl out of San Francisco, her parents are here. They made the trip down, drove down the I-5, and just you can see that right hand just hook right around, Lisa. The technique you use quite a bit.
Yeah, I don't know that was a foul. There was a lot more flopping going on. That's what I saw.
Canepa from St. Ignatius Prep in San Francisco. Dixon went out of the game on her first foul. And Campbell's going to get one going over the back of Jackson, also her first. And the Bruins should be careful with fouls. Not a particularly deep team, UCLA. Markel Walker's coming in for the first time. Normally we see Walker in the starting five, but not today. Nina Earl got the nod.
She had started five straight games until a change was made, and that's a message that Nikki Caldwell, the head coach of UCLA, is sending. You get yanked out of the starting lineup, hey, I better come in and make something happen right away.
And she talked about Markel Walker, how talented she is, aggressive player. She can really help take over games at times, but She just doesn't have the work ethic that Nikki Caldwell is looking for right now. And I think, you know, these are the types of things where you build a culture here where you say, hey, we're only accepting 100% effort every time or you don't start. Nobody's above the law here. And I love that.
Yeah, and that is exactly the word for culture. And it's a culture she learned at the knee of Pat Summitt. She played at Tennessee, won 3 championships, both as a coach, assistant coach, and as a player for the Vols.
And I talked to Nikki. She has a great relationship with Coach Summitt. And you know, if anybody's ever seen Tennessee's program, Pat Summitt does not play. And I love the fact that Nikki's bringing that here and really enforcing that. And then starting with the defense. Her recruiting class is going to continue to get in. They're going to continue to get better as you get more and more talented players. But still, creating that defense, having that hanging on their shoulders, that this is what we're going to do, and the offensive players are tough.
Another turnover for Oregon. That's 8. Now the Bruins showing some teeth at the defensive end like they normally do, but we're also seeing offense. 17-6. UCLA is shooting 62% from the field, and because of that, 17-6 early on against an Oregon team that averages 85 points a game. Let's look around the rest of the Pac-10 and see what's going on. We start actually with one of our players. Nia Jackson has been great for Oregon, and as they close backcourt against Washington State in Washington, she had 22 points in each game. There's a lot of balance in the Conference of Champions. 7 teams already with 10 victories, and we talked about this one already on Thursday night. Stanford, one of the best teams in the country, number 4 against number 10, UCLA. Here's the RPIs. 4 teams in the Pac-10 are in the top 20. And by the way, we're going to have Arizona State and Arizona tomorrow in Tempe.
The duel in the desert, as it's being hyped down there, it's going to be a terrific game. I know we're looking forward to going down there, Jim, and seeing both of the teams. They are coming off a tough weekend in the Bay Area, and it is a huge game for both teams.
Arizona, Arizona State, that's tomorrow, 3 o'clock Mountain, 2 o'clock on the West Coast. We always talk about points in the paint. How about points outside the paint? UCLA 15, Oregon nothing.
And in that last 4-minute segment between media timeouts, Oregon did not score.
Well, it's all about the turnover right now. UCLA really enforcing their will on Oregon. That's their 9th turnover already with 10 minutes. You know, we can average that out. They're going to get about 27, you know, for the game. And you can't win with that. So UCLA is doing an excellent job with their defense.
Well, when your first pass goes to the wing and you are buried on the sideline in a trap, that's not a great way to initiate an offense.
Particularly good job against Jackson. There's Kenyon. Kenyon hit 5 3-pointers against USC the other night, and that's her first 3 of today.
And obviously, when you can knock down 3s, you can close a big lead very, very quickly.
And Oregon is definitely the type of team that's never out of it because they can run off some 3-point shots for you. So UCLA is going to have to really stay aggressive, but also very smart with the ball on offense.
Campbell misses again. Long rebound is pulled down by Ezekwe.
That was the number one thing that this Oregon coaching staff was worried about, the offensive rebounding, not the perimeter shooting of UCLA, but the second and third opportunities, and there it reaps rewards.
Markel Walker, and Walker comes right back and missed the layup. Great steal, good read and react, but she couldn't finish. And we talked to Walker at practice, and she promised a big game. Been down and been off just a little bit of late. Fallen comes right back. Now this is Oregon's game. This is what they want, like a windshield wiper, back and forth.
Jim, you were saying at the USC game, it was like truly an 8-second offense. They were getting down, and most of the evening, they were in an 8-second offense.
That's a good look. Walker outside the zip line. The second time. Going up, stripped, no whistle, and taken away by Deanna Weaver.
She was buried underneath after she got the O board by 3 ducks.
Morgan's going to keep it.
And UCLA got lucky that time with their swarming defense because they were not able to see the whole court. Several players were open that time under the basket. Victoria Kenyon standing there, jumping, running the ball.
Obviously, Nikki Caldwell is aware what a good offensive team Oregon is, but especially from outside, they like to shoot the 3. Nia Jackson with the ball now is outstanding. And I just read that graphic about no points outside the paint for Oregon. So UCLA is extending that defense all the way out to 20 feet. And to Johnson. Oh, left to Zekwe. grasping nothing but air.
Ooh, I love that baseline spin move. That was an awesome move by Johnson.
Amanda Johnson's been under the weather for the last 2 weeks with that horrible chest cold that's been going around, and really under the weather, not playing as well as she had earlier. I think she's coming out of it.
And she just took that one away. A little too strong for Jackson. She's going to look for help. Got it to Weaver. Pull up. Oregon's trying to climb back in it.
Hey, that's the pace they want.
That's amazing that they don't slow down and find, you know, an open shooter. But everybody's a shooter on Oregon, so this would be a great school, a great coach to play for. Paul Westhead, I always wish I had an opportunity to play for him.
I think he took that as a great compliment when you approached him and told him that today.
Shot clock is at 5. Morris, good look. Rattles it in. She's got 6.
The question is, can UCLA continue to shoot the lights out?
Kenyon missed the shot and then got called for the foul. A little frustrating. Victoria Kenyon, who hails from Queensland, Australia. And, of course, all that terrible flooding going on.
Actually, they called that foul on Jasmine Dixon.
Oh, they reversed it, yeah. I looked at Kenyon's face, thought it was on her.
So
getting back to the story with all that terrible flooding in Australia, we asked if Victoria's family and her friends have been affected. And thank goodness for her that everybody's okay, but there's been a loss of life on what they call the Gold Coast in Australia. It's the worst natural disaster ever to hit Australia.
Did you see it? I mean, the pictures were just, oh, so sad.
And cars bobbing in rivers, yeah. Being swept away. Bias misses from outside. Nina Earle. And again, that's what Oregon wants. They want to bait you into taking a quick shot. Jackson pulled up at 17, stayed on her toes. Johnson for 23. And Walker wants to run.
Again, tempo is going to be very important. UCLA this time slowing it down last time. Shots too quick. That's going to hurt you and give Oregon more offensive possession.
I love your comment. Walker wants to run. Nikki Caldwell does not.
Yeah, I think she was the only one who wanted to run there. Again, the shot clock is at 5. Campbell misses from the side. So both Campbell and Morris started out hot and have gone cold. Weaver. Weaver's missed 2 in a row. You got to get her going.
And from a coaching perspective, you would much prefer a team be red hot in the beginning of the game in the first half than in the second half. Defensive standpoint, of course.
I was going to say, Mary, it just depends on what the score is, right?
From a defensive standpoint, hey, burn it out, shoot great, but in the second half, we're going to take over.
Yeah. Walker was a big scorer back in Philly in high school, Shenley High School. She averaged 26 a game. Here she's averaging about 10. It's 5 for her today.
I'm not sure UCLA could shoot any better than they are this afternoon.
And UCLA is shooting better than 50%.
I just love their hustle. You have to be so excited for Nikki Caldwell looking at her team and getting after loose balls, making that effort, diving effort to keep the ball in bounds, and then come back down and knock down jumpers.
Ms. Ekwe, her first bucket.
Great shooting is contagious.
Everybody's hitting for UCLA. They've doubled up the Ducks, 26-13, 6.5 in the first half. Look at the pressure, defensive pressure out at midcourt for UCLA. Not even going to let Oregon set up. They have been stymied as soon as they have gotten to the attacking end. UCLA's defense, heck, how about UCLA's offense? Markel Walker.
I'm not necessarily liking the 80-100 point game of your opponent. I want to keep teams in the 50s, and I love for us to be in the 80s. But it's going to be a fun game. I mean, it has been every year. We love the transition game just as much as they do.
UCLA certainly does today. They're shooting 52%, and they lead by 13 early on. I don't know that Nikki wanted her team to run, but she certainly wanted them to hit shots, and they're doing that.
Well, she has to be excited and happy with the effort that her team made both offensively and defensively.
Well, it's going to be hard for Oregon to run off of made shots. It's a much more difficult transition than off misses.
Oregon's got a dozen turnovers now.
They average 17, so they are at a high clip, and you would expect that against a great defensive team.
Again, he collides with Nina Earl. Actually, going to Ashley Bias for the reach after the collision. That's her first. Bias is a great shooter, transfer for Oregon, but she hasn't gotten a real good open look yet.
Well, Oregon's just made an adjustment there. They're now in man-to-man, trapping on the pick and rolls, just adjusting coming out of that 2-3 zone, the matchup zone that they usually run. And let's see how that affects UCLA's offense.
Popping out to Zekwe, and then a little high-low inside to Ingafo, but it went off her hands and out of bounds. Six turnovers for the Bruins.
Full court to 2-1.
That's Bias. Went off her fingertips. She had to save it. Bruins have numbers. Let's see if they hold this time. Bruins moving the ball well at the offensive end.
Smart decision to pull it out. Slow it up. Away from Walker.
Walker draw and dish on defense. That's what she did. Ingefa had a one-on-one baseline and scored. She has 4 points.
I mean, it's really impressive to see UCLA's defense really bother Oregon's offense. And I'm a little shocked to see that Oregon's having a problem even getting a good shot off, Mary.
I just think a lot of it is that UCLA is shooting the ball so well that they're not able to get transition going because of it.
Zekwe on the tip ball back, and it's an 11-0 UCLA run. Timeout, Paul Westhead and the Oregon Ducks. Now, tomorrow the lights are on. And the house will be rocking. An explosive day of both men's and women's college basketball. First, the women hit the court as Kansas takes on Nebraska. Also, Pac-10 rivals collide. Arizona, Arizona State. That's the game Mary and I will have. And then it's an ACC Sunday night hoops showdown. North Carolina squaring off with Georgia Tech. And in the nightcap, Isaiah Thomas and number 17, Washington, against California. All the action tips off 3 o'clock Eastern, noon Pacific, tomorrow.
That Arizona, Arizona State game, an Arizona team that wants to get up. They want to run, not exactly an Oregon style, but no doubt about it. They just want to run as fast and as hard, get early offense. Transition is 1, 2, and 3 in their option list. If you're Charlie Turner Thorne, you want that half-court game. They're a great defensive team. A little bit of a lost weekend in the Bay Area, but they did defeat a top 25 team in DePaul, and they're having a very, very good season. We saw their RPI at 17.
And I think Arizona State plays very similar to UCLA in terms of their defense and their effort. I mean, she loves to sub in and rotate, keep those players moving in and out. But I really like their style and think that they can possibly slow Arizona down.
Well, what's impressing the heck out of me is that UCLA is doing this with Jasmine Dixon on the bench. 2 personal fouls. She hasn't been on the floor for quite some time, but to a player, they are contributing offensively.
Yeah, Ingefa had that last basket. She has 6 points as Dixon looks on from the bench with the fouls. Ingefa was 6. She only averages 8 points.
Well, this is a great opportunity. Great opportunity for other players to step up. I'm sure Nikki Caldwell will go to her bench and start rotating some players. But, hey, if it's not broken, you just roll with it. And I think because their defense is so effective, the way that they practice, everybody rotates, they all understand the system, you can't go wrong.
And remember what Nikki told us. She said it's leadership by committee taken away there. Boy, Ingefa is playing the best game of the year for her. Pull-up Campbell, 14-footer. Oh, the Bruins are ridiculous right now. They're shooting about 58%.
And one. Markel Walker, nice inside finish.
And that's the maestro, Nikki Caldwell, just calling the defenses. If you score on the layup, I want you in full court pressure, and then you just surprise, grab, and just put it right in. Outstanding job.
Well, the good thing is Dorinda doing a nice job coming up. Campbell, great decision to take the jumper and then to get the steal, pass it back to her teammate. Markel Walker finishing inside.
Amanda Johnson came in as the leading scorer in the Pac-10. She does have 6 points. This was her best move. A little now you see me, now you don't, as she steps right around to Zekwe for the easy basket. Amanda Johnson this year averaging 17-9, leading the Pac-10 in scoring, fourth in rebound. She's also our State Farm Pride of the Pac. She's already graduated. Her undergraduate degree was a double major in psychology and sociology, and she graduated summa cum laude. Last year she was a Pac-10 all-academic first team, so now she's already pursuing her master's degree in couples and family therapy, and Oregon might need some of that help on the bus going home, because right now nothing is going right for them, and they're talking to themselves.
Had so much AP credit when she entered as a freshman that she was basically a sophomore. Graduated with a double major before her junior year.
She was never a freshman. I was a freshman 3 times.
I love it. That's amazing.
That is a pride of the pack right there.
Seen the points off turnovers. UCLA was 16 points off those Oregon turnovers. 15 Oregon turnovers, 16 UCLA points. And after that free throw now, 17 points for UCLA.
We talk about therapy and family counseling. Yes. UCLA was doing some of that yesterday. Nikki Caldwell, very unhappy with the job they did. As we look at the steal totals in the NCAA, UCLA right up there.
And Oregon right behind them.
With the 20 turnovers, that Oregon State turned into 30 points.
3.5 minutes to play in the first half. And Kenepa's going to get called, I believe, here for a reach on Ingefa. They'll get Jackson instead. Jackson picks up her second foul.
As well as Oregon played in that close loss downtown against USC on Thursday night, Jim, that they just had never been in this ballgame.
Yeah, they had a good chance to win that game. They led SC most of the night. Ingefa! Pump fake, put it on the floor.
I like Ingefa. She's still raw. You can see when she goes to the basket. Not sure how she's going to finish, but the fact that she went hard, I'm sure Coach Caldwell's loving that.
Nicole Kenepa, nice move inside, finishing with the left, her first bucket.
And it has been a while for Oregon.
They get Walker for the walk.
Walker, he's doing. I think, again, UCLA doing a nice job of breaking the press, get it up, then bring it back out, slow it down. It's to their advantage with this big of a lead. You don't want to give Oregon more offensive possession.
Oregon has gone 7.5 minutes now without a point. Make it 6.5 minutes without a point. UCLA on an 18-0 run. And Westhead has burned a couple of timeouts trying to slow down the train. Morris just picked up her second foul, so she's going to go to the bench, and Maria Williams is going to come in. The foul will see Maria Williams in the game. She's on defense right now, standing just 5'3", working against Jackson, and slapped at the ball.
This is going to be exciting to watch the battle of the littles going at it, because they're both so quick. And Jackson, again, hasn't been that effective yet, Mary, but usually she's so fast getting down the court, very hard to stop. But Mariah, she's 5'2".
At least how often do you see a player comes into the game and you want to make something happen? You're right in front of your bench, your coach is standing there, and you take a swipe at it. Unnecessary, because now an opportunity for Oregon to score points. It has been a struggle for them to score, and you just sort of offered it up on a platter.
Ania Jackson with that free throw gets her first point of the game. She came in averaging 16 points a game, second leading scorer for the Ducks, and had 3 games in a row at 20 points, had been in double figures in 17 straight, so the Bruins have completely shut her down.
Williams is recent. Mariah Williams with the ball right now, actually 5'4". Sorry, Mariah, I get you back here a little 2 inches. There.
Oh, 5'4", I had her at 5'3", all right, we'll all make our adjustments.
Yeah.
Oregon switching on a lot of screens.
Campbell against Kenepa. Mismatch. Kick it back out to the top. Off the mark by Rayma Gardner.
Again, the harassment of the rebounder trying to slow down the break.
Jackson looks over her shoulder, pulls up. Again, halfway down, comes out. Rebound Holiday. Nothing will go in for Oregon.
Oregon really struggling on the board, struggling to put the ball in. Nia Jackson missing, you know, chippies that she normally puts in. And that's what happens when you start to lose confidence because of this warming defense, then your offense really starts to suffer and you don't take as good of a high percentage shot.
Yeah, Oregon is shooting just 33%, but it's a confidence thing now. You can see they're all thinking about it now. They're trying to guide their shots. Well, I mentioned already tomorrow, you're going to leave here, get on a plane and go down to the desert. They call it the Duel in the Desert. It's the Territorial Cup. Arizona against Arizona State. Kimberly Brandon's in a new position for the Sun Devils.
Yeah, they moved her from the three to the power forward position, but she's just so good around the rim, 15 feet and in, and Devlin White, boy, what a sensational freshman year she had. Building on that, talked to Coach Charlie Turner Thorne this morning. We talked to Coach Nia Butts yesterday, and it's the Duel in the Desert. There's a lot of hype going on down there, and now, the last couple years, this is a big game. In years past, it's been all ASU. Not so much anymore. Both teams really getting it after it.
Yeah, the last five have been real close. Pull up Campbell. Didn't have her feet set. Gardner, the acrobatic follow. UCLA will keep it with 2:04 in the first half.
I think it's a very important 2 minutes, the last 2 minutes of this half, for especially Oregon, because you want to go in, you chip away at this lead a little bit. They can score in bunches. Second half, that's not a problem, but you just want to get it as close as you can.
Down 21. Normally, we talk about keeping it under 10 at the break, but that's a dream for Oregon right now.
Yeah, getting it under 10 is going to be tough, yeah. But you want to close the gap and gain some sort of momentum before you go in at the half.
Walker again draws two defenders with her and kicks to the open teammate Ingefa.
I mean, UCLA just doing a nice job of executing. When they slow it down, they've gotten some really good shots and they've been able to set up their defense and cause more turnovers.
Kenepa walks in the backcourt. She was left. All the guards turn their backs.
And now you start to look at the body language of the Oregon players. They look like they're defeated. You know, it becomes such an uphill battle when you're trying to regain and catch up when you're down by so much and your offense isn't going well.
17 turnovers now for the Ducks. Completely debilitated any type of rally.
But look, that's why halftime is a great time for Oregon. For UCLA, they much prefer, let's just play on. Forget about halftime. We don't need to have any stoppage.
Williams. Yeah, 5-2, 5-3, 5-4, doesn't matter. Take it inside with the trees.
Nice job getting to the basket. Mariah Williams says, hey, take that. I may be little, but I can get in here with the big girls.
Just
nice drives.
But it was really the seal off inside by Markel Walker that opened that drive up for Mariah. At her size, you need all the help you can get. She's certainly got some.
Mariah Williams from Aurora, Colorado, won a high school state title at Regis Jesuit. And she said she wants to be Nate Robinson for a day so she can bang on a seven-footer.
That is hilarious.
All the littles want to go inside.
Yeah, they always want to come inside, and she wants to dunk, right? And big, what do we want to do? We want to be the point guard. Of course.
You can enjoy shooting that three, Lisa. There's no doubt about it.
And then Coach Cooper's like, smooth, get on the block.
Jackson at the free throw line again. You know, Paul Westhead likes to say that Nia Jackson is the barometer for this Oregon team. And he says, when she doesn't play well, we don't play well. Well, Jackson has just 3 points, and Oregon's getting routed. Williams at the other end.
An open net goal.
Very good, Mary. 43-18, Jackson. And here's Williams again. Everyone's going to run this time. Ingefa to the right, the no look. Followed by Gardner. Tipped out, and Walker will be the first one to it.
Again, UCLA doing just a little bit too much, and Nikki's all the way up like, hey, slow it down. But again, control, that's going to be the key for them. Continue to control the tempo and get ready for the second half.
30 seconds. No question about UCLA's fitness. Maybe all that running's helping them out.
It's definitely helping them out. And I think the biggest thing Nikki probably wanted from them was to get their attention. Hey, come out, understand what we want to do on defense. Offensively, they're doing a great job of moving the ball around and knocking down their shots.
The biggest halftime deficit for Oregon this year has been 14 points. That's about to change. Ingefa, she's got 10 points in the first half. She only averages 8 a game. Everybody's contributing for UCLA. That's exactly what Caldwell wanted. At practice, she was talking about everybody finding a way to help out your teammates. and the Bruins lead 45-18. Nikki Caldwell's got to be very happy. She's with Mary Murphy.
Did you see this one coming?
Well, I didn't necessarily think that we're going to shoot the ball extremely well, but anytime you play Oregon, they force you to play a transition game, and that's something that we like to do ourselves. We're just making shots, you know, but the second half, we got to be better defensively. We missed some assignments. But I like the tempo and the energy of our team right now.
This is an Oregon team that can score a lot of points. Is this lead safe against this Oregon team?
No, not at all. I think that when you look at Oregon, their ability to shoot the three ball, we still got to have long closeouts. Know that the rebound is coming off long. But again, this team is playing with a lot of heart, a lot of intensity, and a lot of energy.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Nikki Caldwell's Bruins have forced Oregon into 17 turnovers, and off those 17 giveaways, the Bruins 19 points. UCLA shoots 54% in the first half, and it is a Bruin blitz in Westwood.
Well, this is the start over, so let's throw that away and get after it.
Paul Westhead, when you're down by 27 points at halftime? Hey, it's start overtime. Just forget about it. Let's begin anew. 45-18 UCLA. I got to admit, Lisa, I didn't see this coming.
I didn't see this coming either, because Oregon usually so prolific from three. They run the floor, all those quick shots. You're used to them putting up so many points. But we have to just give all the credit to UCLA. Nikki Caldwell and her coaching staff have done a tremendous job with this team, understanding what it is that they want their team to come out and do. And they've been able to do that and execute it on both ends of the floor.
Paul Westhead has coached more than 1,000 games, so he knows when a cause is lost in the first half, just leave it behind, start fresh.
Well, his assistants told the story before the game that when he was a pro coach with the Lakers, he would just get devastated by poor halves and poor games. And at one point after a game, the next day, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar came up, and we all know how tall he is, put his hand on his shoulder and said, "Coach, it's time to get over it." And he said he's learned that lesson, and it's time to move on. And it's another 20 minutes. It took 20 minutes to build the lead. Now Oregon's got 20 minutes to get it back.
And Oregon, remember, averages about 43 points a half. So it's not impossible for them to come back. But they're going to need to hit almost every shot.
Well, look, you have UCLA coming out like that. Darina Campbell, aggressive, nice pass down over to Jasmine Dixon. And that's a strong move. She's a big girl. She didn't try to go around. She went through her, and now she's at the line being rewarded with two shots.
Dixon, who spent most of the first half on the bench with those two fouls, starts the second half.
Every possession, defensively and offensively, are huge for Oregon. Their margin for error, if they want to win the game, is very small. UCLA's margin for error is very large. You can use timeouts, you can talk. There's no pressure on UCLA. They're in great shape. But for Oregon, yeah, every possession is important.
Well, I think the only thing Nikki Caldwell could be worried about is UCLA's offense. They're not usually shooting the ball that well, as we said, in the first half. And if they begin to miss more shots, that will give Oregon more offensive opportunities.
Johnson scores quickly for Oregon at one end, and then Ingefe gets the roll at the other end. She's got 12 points to lead the Bruins. Holiday was too far underneath.
Looks like what Ingefe did. You take what the defense gives. Don't try to do too much. Just, I got this 5 foot shot. Take the 5 foot shot. Expect Oregon defensively to be much more aggressive.
Kick out to Campbell. Well, Darina Campbell likes that left side baseline jumper.
So they just negated the 4-0 run by Oregon.
And they did a nice job of inside. When you're going against a zone, you want to get the ball inside, draw on the defense, and then they were able to kick it back out for the jumper.
Taken away by Dixon. She's in front of everyone. Jackson gives up on her.
The thing about Jazz, they built a 27-point lead with her spectating, so she wants to get in on the party a little bit.
She's got 9 points.
Jasmine Dixon only played 8 minutes.
Johnson back in Dixon all the way inside. Dixon swatted it away for a second. Johnson gets it back and scores.
Johnson's
she's in double
really
figures.
Struggling, though. She's struggling tonight because usually she scores so much easier, and she's having a difficult time getting the ball in the basket.
And there's Joexia Morris at the other end for UCLA. for Johnson, and Mary mentioned it in the first half, she's had that respiratory illness in her chest for the last week and a half, hasn't practiced a whole lot, probably doesn't have her wind.
Great defensive play by Dorina Campbell.
Lisa, you and I have talked about defense before, and defense is just so much desire and effort. At halftime, Nikki Caldwell was talking about intensity and effort for UCLA. Did she deliver that message by making them run or by talking to them?
I think both, because what she says is profound. And as a player, you know when your coach is like, what are they talking about? Or you really get it. And they are owning up to the fact that they didn't come out with the effort and intensity that they needed against Oregon State. Although they won the game, it's just not playing up to a certain level. And as you begin to move further up in rankings, there's a certain level of expectation that comes with that. And UCLA is starting to understand that.
And I think that's what Nikki was a little upset about, that they didn't understand that on Thursday night.
Remember last time we were here, which was a week ago, UCLA against USC. USC, one of the better teams on the West Coast, completely shut down by this UCLA defense. And they've done it to a lot of teams. In Earl outside. Well, the Ducks are certainly competing. You have to give them that. Last week when USC was getting work, they came out those first 4 minutes and they didn't look like they wanted to play.
Jim, you're hilarious. When USC was getting work.
It wasn't close.
It was not close. And it was, again, we were shocked again. We didn't expect to see USC's offense suffer the way that they did. But again, we cannot give enough credit to UCLA, their defense, the pressure that they're putting on teams, and they definitely deserve to be ranked in the top 10 in the nation.
What is it they do, Lisa, besides that outside pressure that we pointed out in the first half?
They make every shot you attempt difficult, whether there's a player in front of you, whether they come over there and trap you, they get a hand on the ball. It really forces you to play at a much faster tempo than most teams would like to play. And as a shooter, you want to be in your comfort zone. You want to be able to shoot in your normal rhythm, and they take you out of that.
Just like that, Johnson misses a five-foot bunny inside. Mary, offensively, how do you counter it? If somebody's up in your grill all the time, you play over the top?
Well, I think you have to keep the ball away from the sidelines, because they're trapping it like their life depends on it. And two, when you see a trap coming, you got to reverse it. Find open people.
The other advice I would give to a team playing against a UCLA defense, you got to work when you don't have the ball. I would have to screen and seal, get myself in the right proper position in the low space. So once the ball arrives, I know I'm just turning and putting it up in the basket.
But the bottom line for Oregon is they are a full court team. And when you have a UCLA team shooting the ball exceptionally well, you don't have an opportunity to do what you do best. They are not a great half court offense. They are a great full court offense.
Last year, this UCLA women's team went to the second round of the NCAA. Of course, this is the house that Wooden built. We come back, we'll look at one of his title teams.
Time now to honor the extraordinary man we will always call Coach. Coach John R. Wooden was known for his discipline, his attention to detail, and his patience. And after 16 years of coaching the UCLA Bruins, that patience paid off in his first national championship in 1964. What they lacked in size, they made up for in speed and quickness. Led by 6'1 Gale Goodrich and 6'4 Walt Hazard, UCLA never lost a game that season. And John R. Wooden had his first title. And we remember him best by his own words. Earn the right to be proud and confident.
Everybody called Wooden Coach, but Coach Wooden referred to himself as a teacher. Because of him, Pauley Pavilion is the mecca of college basketball, the 10 national championships that he brought here to Westwood. And the players, the legacy of John Wooden continues on in Westwood. He passed away at the age of 99.
And you see the pyramid as part of that patch. That's the Pyramid of Success, which was a book that Coaching 101, you want to coach, you better go get that book. It'll inspire you and give you some great ideas on how to be successful.
And what I loved about the pyramid, it also applied to teamwork was the main thing about building that foundation, being reliable, being a trustworthy teammate, being confident, and making sure that you're helping each other out. So I use the pyramid also in our relationship, too.
And, of course, this year on both the men's and women's side in the Pac-10, the Coach of the Year Award is named after John Wooden. Let's take a look at the Wooden Award, which is the top 20 players in the country, and three Pac-10 players are on this week's list. What is it? It's down to 20 now, and no surprise to see Nneka Ogwumike and Kayla Peterson from Stanford, but Jasmine Dixon has also been recognized. Finally, Marion, it's not just her numbers and her effort, like right there, but it's the fact she's doing it undersized, down on the block.
And it's what UCLA did at the end of last year when they went, got to the NCAA tournament and really did such a terrific job, and just the national level of recognition that's coming to UCLA because of that and what they're doing in games like last week and this week on national TV is really elevating this program once again to national prominence.
First time since 2001 that the Bruins are back in the top 10 starting this game as the number 10 team in the nation in the AP rankings. Jackson turns, and Drexy Moore stepped right into her personal space and took the charge.
Every outlet is challenged. Every dribble when you're trying to push the ball is challenged. Shot goes up. You're going to watch Jackson, and who's sitting right there? Drexy Morris. You got to go through me if you want to get up the floor. That's just outstanding recognition.
Charge on Jackson is her third foul. And none of that much matters with UCLA up 34 points deep into the second half. Oregon is going to have to leave this game behind at some point and start thinking about next week when they go home. They have Oregon State to open the new Matthew Knight Arena in Eugene. We'll have that game for you next weekend. And then they have Stanford coming in the Thursday after that. And I believe we're doing that game as well. Westhead is up, and you can see the aggravation on his face now because he's made all of his adjustments, all of his changes. He's reached deep into the book, and finally he just told him, forget about the first half, let's start over, and yet it lingers on.
Well, you guys have both talked about Ingefund, the way she's played offensively. Great job on the defense down here. Now, don't worry about the sideline. Got their foot on it, and the ball goes out of bounds, and Jackson goes out of bounds with it.
Morris. Long rebound taken by Danielle Love, a freshman from Everett, Washington, who's getting a lot of time for the Ducks this year. Fallen from the corner. That's Christy Fallen from Roseburg, Oregon.
You just feel at some point the Ducks are going to make a run.
Well, you know, the Ducks barely scored, so they haven't even got an opportunity to get into their face, full-face press that usually forces the other teams to run a fast offense.
How will UCLA react when the shot stops falling? That's the question that I have in this second half.
Well, what if, Mary, they don't stop falling? What if UCLA has now gotten to a rhythm where they're nice defensively, obviously, but now they're going to become a better offensive team? I mean, that just goes to show the space that they have, the growth that they have. And maybe, just think, if they shoot this well against Stanford, we've got a real game on our hands.
You know, just watching Amanda Johnson, she has missed that last shot for Oregon. You can tell that illness is still getting to her because she's tired. She's walking around with her hands on her hips. You can see the mouth is open.
You know, when you're working on Arena Campbell over on the sideline, that's why we're having a little stoppage of play.
But to your point, Jim, I've been there where you can't breathe through your nose and you're just out there playing and it just feels like, you know, you're just, your head is just, oh, it's a tough time to play when you're feeling sick out there. But, you know, you push through. I've actually had some of my best games, though, when sick.
Yeah, you know, I've seen players do that before. Michael Jordan had that great game in the NBA Finals
right.
He was so sick. Remember that?
Sometimes it
allows a player to just focus.
Just working on the right hand of Darina Campbell. It's like the little finger just did a quick tape job, clean that thing up, and off we go.
And Johnson went quickly to the bench for Oregon.
Defense by Oregon.
Walker. Markel Walker.
You know what I'm loving about UCLA is the drive and kick. Very unselfish team. They're playing together and making sure they find the open player. When you find that open player like that, open jumpers, you're bound to knock them down.
I know a lot of Markel's family watching back in the Philadelphia area, and we were teasing her at practice because we've been waiting for her to have a breakout game. She's a tremendous talent, and she's just been off a little bit this year, having trouble getting a rhythm of late. But today she's got 12 points, and that's the pure jumper that she made famous at Schenley High in Philly.
Drive the dish you were talking about, Lise.
Dixon.
That's just pretty. Nice, unselfish team ball. Finding the open player. And that's the point I was making. When you have to work on the offense, you have to get the defense sealed behind you. And Dixon did a nice job
Lisa, as you know, it's all about the timing of the cut. Jasmine Dixon relaxed till the defense is in a position where he could step into that gap. She does it. The ball was delivered in time.
Let me ask both of you this question. It's a 35-point game, and UCLA just pressed after a made basket. Is that all right?
Well, you know, you have to be afraid of an Oregon team because of their ability to shoot the three ball. I'm not sure you want to let up, and so I, too, would have continued to press. Maybe it's a lighter press. Maybe you drop back. You probably won't see the trapping, but they have to continue to send that message that we're in this game. There's a lot of time left as well.
Nikki Caldwell, in her third season at UCLA, already has piled up 58 victories. Last year they went 25-9, went to the second round of the NCAA, and she was the Pac-10 Coach of the Year. Certainly has made a big impact in a short amount of time in Westwood.
But you said it before. Look nice too. I like that. They dress so nice. I love the way they're staffed. We have three ladies and you know, well, four ladies and a gentleman on the bench, but they always look really nice. And that sends a great message. You know, it's women's basketball, but they look beautiful.
Yeah, Stacey Terry and Tasha Butts over there. Tony Peroni is to the far left. Yeah, Tony looks good today too. He cleans up well.
Yeah.
And Pam Walker, UCLA Director of Basketball Operations over there on the bench, also for UCLA. There she is.
Pam. Pam's been here forever. When I played, Pam was here. So she's always a great person. For any UCLA knowledge, she knows it all.
Sure, she'll appreciate that, Lisa. Knocked away, taken away by Derexia Morris.
Great trap. They drove her back to half court. You can't go back over and just could not handle the UCLA pressure.
Bias' shot is long, taken on the backside by Weaver. And Weaver scores on the runner through the lane.
Let me just make this point. Weaver has not passed the ball to anyone since entering the game. When she gets it, like every shot is a good shot. It's her shot, but she knocked that one down.
Well, she's a young freshman out of Santa Clara that they're very excited about. They expect big things from her.
Walker, nice look inside to Gardner. The ball was deflected just a little bit, and I think it threw Gardner's timing off.
I don't know. Gardner, a freshman also. She threw it up there a little fast. Probably nervous.
No love for the kids. Let's take a look around the rest of the Pac-10. We know about Stanford and their upset over UConn, knocking off that 90-game streak. What's up with California? Joanne Boyle and the Golden Bears, they beat Arizona State earlier in the year, but this week, Mary, they lose at Washington State.
Well, they're a very young team. They turned the ball over a lot, and Lisa, I thought you had an interesting observation that that's just a darn tough place to play.
Oh, man, Washington State. I've had some bad games there. Luckily, we've come out with wins, but they were all ugly, so I can identify with Cal struggling up there in Washington State.
UCLA is beating Oregon by 34 points. And Oregon is the highest scoring team in the Pac-10, but not today. The UCLA defense, which is best in the conference, has been outstanding.
In a game that has impressed us in so many ways for UCLA, one thing that stands out for me is the great balance that they've had in scoring. I think seven different players have scored. They're sharing the ball extremely well.
Yeah, and five players in double figures for UCLA. That's one of them. Derexia Morris. Morris has 12 points. Kenepa going to go to the line. Chance at a three-point play.
One of the few times Oregon's been able to really move quickly down the floor, get the ball inside to Kenepa, where she has an opportunity to shoot a three-point play. But I'm just surprised Oregon not really adjusting, Mary, their defense. Maybe changing it up some more. They went man-to-man, we saw it for a few times, but again, they're just kind of content with this loss.
Well, I think the bottom line is they are all about offense. That is what they are built for. Jim, an interesting comment by Paul Westhead yesterday at practice that really indicates, you know, that's what their focus is, and they have not been able to get going off misses. They've just been smothered by traps. Whether it's the rebounder or the outlet pass, and they've never been able to get it going.
Zekwe from the corner for UCLA. Now, Oregon averages 85 points a game, but when I looked at the numbers, I noticed that Oregon also forced 14 steals and 26 turnovers a game. So I said to Coach Westhead, I don't think you get enough credit for your defense. And he just smiled at me and said, yeah, we don't talk a lot about defense. We just try to outscore you. That's normally their plan. It didn't work today.
Well, it looks like they've kind of cleared their bench a little with Ariel Thomas right there, the freshman, going to the basket. And, hey, why not get the experience? She's playing against a tough defense right now and doing a nice job of taking care of the ball.
UCLA, 54% from the field. We keep talking about the defense. Mary, you pointed out at halftime how well UCLA is shooting at the offensive end as well. There's Walker again. Here's the big game that Walker promised. She came over right before we went on air, and she said, today's the day. I feel it today. She didn't start. She got pulled out of the starting lineup. They got her attention.
Well, that's exactly what you want to see from a coaching perspective, is how is the player going to react? How are they going to come to play when they're not going to start? She has done a very nice job.
Canepa's fouled inside. She'll go back to the line. And Markel Walker is such a great talent, and she's a young player. It's just a matter of motivating her at certain times.
Well, she has to learn to stay motivated because they need her, and her ability to shoot from outside at that small forward position is going to be something that they're going to need to rely on a little bit more, wouldn't you say, Mary?
I would. I think she's extremely talented, and as things ebb and wane, that's what drives coaches crazy, because they look at players and see the potential, and they want what they're doing to just continue to get to that point.
One thing I found as a player is that it's important to practice the way you want to play, and I think a lot of young players don't understand that. It's important, and I think once Markel Walker realizes how she practices will affect the way she plays, she'll be much more consistent.
Good move inside by Nina Earle. She hadn't scored before, so UCLA has somebody else in the scorebook. Taken away again by Walker. And they'll get her for a double dribble on the baseline. That's the other thing about Walker, not just offense. She has those long arms, big wingspan, and gets to almost every ball.
But the fact that she's the size of a guard really is deceiving, because she can get in there. She has fast hands. She's quick. She can also score inside over the paint, over the post. And then she can step out and knock down the jumper.
Out of Philadelphia, her sister went to Pitt and had a tremendous All-American career. The decision to come west, and Pitt recruited her as a point guard, you guys. So they had great vision, and they thought that she could just handle the ball. UCLA doesn't have a lot of size. She's had to play some four and some three, but boy, is she versatile.
Canepa spinning inside, and Canepa's going back to the line. So all of a sudden, Nicole Canepa has caught fire for Oregon. She's got 8 points and going back to the stripe.
Well, she sees she has the freshman Costa on her back, so she does a nice up and under move, spinning around to the left off the glass.
Nicole Canepa, who's been fighting sprained ankles the last couple seasons, is finally healthy. And today is her 100th game as an Oregon Duck. Quickly the other way.
Last year she set the single game Oregon record for scoring. She had 38 in the game.
Beautiful high-low. Kareen Costa inside for UCLA. Nice separation.
That was a nice job of getting that ball back, because that chippy, missing chippies inside. But, you know, we have the freshmen out here, so they're a little nervous, a little shy. You know, you come out, and it's exciting. I remember when I was a freshman, you know, you make some of those mistakes, missed baskets that you should make, and then you sort of gain your confidence.
Kareen Costa, who went to Liberty High School, which is in Brentwood, not the one just outside these doors, but the one up in Central California.
Off Highway 4. Northern California, you just take I-80, and before you hit the bridge, you just head on over there.
Costa was a great athlete in high school, not just a basketball player, but she was the MVP in both basketball and volleyball in her league. Jim Watson, Mary Murphy, Lisa Leslie at Pauley Pavilion. UCLA, number 10 in the nation, having their way with Oregon, 75-40, and Oregon came in as the number one scoring team in the Pac-10, averaging 85 points a game. The UCLA defense has been suffocating. The Bruins have also shot 55% from the field. Bias had to get it off with two on the shot clock and was fouled.
That's just aggressiveness taken maybe to another level. Every shot contests. And I remember talking to Nikki Caldwell last year as we take a look at Paul Westhead, who's not too happy with what's been going on. Nikki described it as, we want our players to be ball magnets. Wherever the ball is, that's where you are to be. And we have seen that over the last 2 weeks. Do it as well as anybody in the country. Get after it defensively.
The other thing we have not seen Oregon do is drive and kick. They haven't really moved the ball around well. In fact, they've been trying to penetrate, create their own shots, which has really been more to UCLA's advantage defensively.
You know, we've all been to a number of UCLA practices here in the last couple of weeks, and one of the things that Nikki Caldwell talked about and the message she's trying to deliver to this young UCLA team is that, sure, you're 14-1 and you're 10th in the nation, but you're not as good as you think you are. And as Nikki said, I can see what's on the horizon. And I think she was talking about that trip to the Bay Area against Cal and especially against Stanford. She said, I can see it. I don't know that the players do. Well, she delivered that other message about increasing their intensity and their effort today. But can UCLA play with Stanford?
I think UCLA can play with Stanford in the sense of their defense can cause problems. You have Poland, who's a great ball handler at the helm of Stanford's offense. Peterson, a very tall guard, not as great a dribbler, so she has to be really strong with it. But overall, Stanford, too big, too much.
Yeah, and of course they have the Ogwumike sisters. Chinee, the freshman, and Nneka, the junior, and player of the year in the Pac-10. That's Thursday for UCLA. ...25 years of women's athletics in the Pac-10 Conference inside historic Poly Pavilion. And UCLA is handling Oregon 77-42. The Bruins are going to improve to 5-0 in the conference. Let's take a look around the rest of the Pac-10. Washington and Washington State. And how about the Cougars with a couple of wins in a row in conference, Mary?
And what a huge game last night, beating Cal by 14. Went to the internet, saw some YouTube, and they did about a five-minute segment. They were up 20 at one point. Sage Romberg was just lefty, about 6 foot, just cannon threes from long distance. It is the first time in 10 years that Washington State has won two straight games in conference that may come to an end with Stanford coming to town. But it was an interesting comment by Paul Westhead after his team only beat Washington State by five. Media was kind of giving him a hard time. He said they're the best 2-13 team in the country. They're going to surprise a lot of people. June Doherty, the cup is always half full. She has done a great job keeping that ship pointed in the right direction.
Christy Fallon for Oregon.
I certainly stand corrected. I didn't think UCLA could shoot any better. They are shooting 58% in the second half, shot 54 in the first.
Maybe a new sign of the time, Mary. UCLA, prolific, both offensively and defensively. Can you see it?
We will, time will tell. I think the important thing is knowing who you are. They know who they are defensively. That's what's important.
Kennepa got dumped. Looks like she's okay. And a foul on Nina Earle.
It's just amazing to see Oregon has 26 turnovers. And not taking care of the ball at all. Not really making a whole lot of adjustments to UCLA's defense, even to slow down. You recognize they're going to come, they're swarming, they're trapping, and again, Oregon's still doing the same thing, expecting a different result.
But if you think about the entire game and every offensive possession by Oregon, how many times were they able to put the ball on the floor or make a pass without real harassment? Not very many.
And as you say that, another turnover as it's taken away by the UCLA defense and converted to points. That's been the story all day long. Nina Earle has four. Jackson gets fouled. Boy, it has been a tough day for Nia Jackson. She came in averaging 16 points a game. She has four, and they're all from the free throw line. She's 0 for 4 from the field. Remember that this is a woman who came in scoring 20 points in her last three games. The last Oregon Duck to score 20 in four straight was the great Shaquayla Williams.
Jim, that usually doesn't happen on my star watch. You know, I talked about Nia Jackson in the open. She's coming off that 25-point game, 11 assists, and UCLA has shut her down.
She has had no room to breathe. In the outlet area, she's surrounded. She hits half court, someone's right in her face, and they're just down in stance. It's textbook. Just make them work. And when your hands are up, you got a whole lot longer distance to get turned around and to get around a corner than you do if you just sort of stand in there. That you just have to commend UCLA for their defense.
And UCLA is going to call a timeout. 6:25 to play. UCLA 81, Oregon 47. Take a look at the rivals of our two teams today. Oregon State, Scott Ruick, they've been competitive in every game, Mary. They haven't won in conference, but what a job he's done in a short amount of time.
He really has. It's been all about defense, positioning, rebound. Don't beat yourself. And when you inherit a program that was in as much trouble as them, he's done an outstanding job.
And we're going to see Scott Ruick and the Beavers of Oregon State against the Oregon Ducks as they open Matthew Knight Arena. They call it Matt Court. Close to 13,000 seats. It is a beautiful facility. The men opened it the other night against USC and beat the Trojans. We'll have Oregon State on the women's side at the mat. Matt Court next Sunday.
It's kind of fun. The old court was Matt Court. The new court is Matt Court.
Yeah, I love venerable old Matt Court. They finally had to close it down. It was the oldest on-campus facility in the country, 1928.
Yeah, that's so good. I was gonna. They popcorn a lot over there too. Man, that place is kind of rickety. But it was fun.
Yeah.
I liked the way the crowd was right up on you, though. That was always fun.
The Bruins still playing hard.
Yeah, and that's an interesting observation, Jim, because it's so easy with a big lead. You look up there to maybe get comfortable. They have never taken their foot off the gas.
Campbell, and it was blocked. Costa inside. Green Costa's getting some points today.
Costa's getting some time, and the big girl really needs to make a mark inside, continue to establish herself offensively, and then get in there and really be a presence on defense.
Amanda Johnson for Oregon now has 12 points. Johnson came in averaging 17, leading scorer in the Pac-10.
This is a UCLA staff that keeps a lot of statistics, and they grade things out offensively, defensively. There's six major areas, and they grade out it in four different categories in those areas. And a lot of C minuses and Ds from the Oregon State game. The grading today, vastly improved.
Jackson from 14. First field goal of the game for Nia Jackson, 7 points.
Well, I think you said earlier, Jim, that the team goes as Nia Jackson goes, first field goal, not good.
Especially coming off a 25-point game over across town.
Yeah, she had 25 points and 11 assists against USC. And that may be the last we see of her. And at some point, Paul Westhead has to figure, okay, well, that's it. Let's pack the suitcases, get on the bus, and head to the airport. Last weekend in L.A. They had SC beat, or at least they had a comfortable lead on SC late in the second half, but the women of Troy answered and won it by three.
One of the things we've talked to the UCLA players about a lot is last year and years past, they spent time chasing other teams. Now the target is on their back, and how different is it? They've reacted very well in this game to being the 10th ranked team in the country.
Johnson from way outside. As Gardner had just picked up UCLA's 15th steal last time down.
Oregon still dropping back in their matchup zone.
You want to see man-to-man?
I would have preferred to see Oregon come out and challenge more of the shooters. Once you saw that UCLA is shooting the ball very well, I thought they should have made more of an adjustment, put a little bit more pressure on them. And obviously you don't necessarily want UCLA driving to the paint, but you really had to run them off of the 15 and 17-foot jumpers.
Nzekwe. When Nzekwe and Ingafa, among others, have been the big surprises for UCLA. Oregon wants to run. The Bruins want to walk. 83. a huge day for the Bruins. 83-54, and if you were with us at the beginning, we had a soundbite from Nikki Caldwell, the UCLA head coach, and we were talking to her about Oregon averaging 80 points a game, and she said, well, I don't necessarily like that unless we're the team in the 80s, and I like to see them down in the 50s. That's what happened.
Wow, that really came to pass, didn't it? Right?
3 minutes and 30 seconds to play.
But I bet you Tara Vanderveer and her staff is sitting up in, I think they stay in Moscow, Idaho, for the trip to Washington State. I think the scout has already commenced for UCLA, and a tireless worker who is just going to get after it and watch this game probably 5-6 times and get ready for the Bruins and what they will bring to Maples on Thursday night.
Yeah, UCLA at Stanford Thursday. Stanford number 4 in the nation, UCLA number 10.
We're going to learn a whole lot more about UCLA by the end of next weekend, and then they follow up with Cal, who plays very well at home.
Stanford's won more than 50 games in a row at home, as Danielle Love hits again for the Ducks. Couple in a row, 6 points for her.
Oregon really able to do what they want to do now that there's 2 to 3 minutes left in the game, moving the ball around and able to step out and shoot three-point shots.
I don't know if you saw that graphic quickly. That's the first three for UCLA today. That last three for them, they've had 1-3 the whole game. That's amazing, with 83 points. Oregon's on a 10-0 run right now. That's over.
Nice move by Christina Nzekwe. Big, strong, tough player. They talk about how tough she is. She loves to get after it.
Campbell just ripped it away. Under 2 minutes.
Good.
It's a smart move by the senior to pull the ball out, reset it. UCLA not in a rush.
Well, you said it, Lisa. These are minutes that are so valuable. You prove to your coaching staff, hey, you can trust me on the floor. I will make good things happen. Not going to make mistakes.
Taken away by Williams. 30 turnovers for Oregon. 30.
I said 27. I was off by 2.
Shot clock's at 5.
The great thing is just the way the crowd, the band comes out and supports the UCLA women's team. And with these types of wins, the more people will come out and support that. And that's what you love to see, is just the growth where Nikki Caldwell has come here and her staff preparing their team to be able to play great basketball right here in Westwood. And, I mean, when you start wiping teams out like this, I mean, it really does send a message to the community that this is the type of game, this is where you want to be. This is great for the whole staff.
Well, Lisa, you and I live in Los Angeles, and we know that people now are talking about Nikki Caldwell and the UCLA women's program. They're going to improve not just to 5-0 in conference, but 15-1 on the season, the one loss to LSU, back in the top 10, first time since 2001. The word's out, and this is a town that loves a winner, and Nikki Caldwell is a winner.
And Mary, you talked about it last week, that they're used to sneak up on you because you weren't sure what you were going to get with UCLA. They're no secret anymore. In the top 10 in the nation, teams are going to prepare for them, and it's going to be interesting to see how they respond next week playing Stanford.
At Stanford, in front of 6,000 people, the number 4 team in the nation. UCLA, a young team going on the road. Now, Oregon's worst loss before this day was 19 points to Arizona State. That says it all, doesn't it?
It does.
Just never really in it.
Taken away by Williams again. You know she's going. Now she'll go to the line with 27 seconds.
And Mariah Williams does a nice job of making contact. She knows her size and her height, but she does a good job of really getting into the body, drawing that contact, and then she just tosses it up there, and every now and then it goes in, and sometimes it doesn't. But with that contact, she's at the line.
Seven points for Mariah Williams on the day.
And surprisingly, Jim, at her size, she's only 66% free throw shooter. Usually the smaller guards are much better shooters. But she's working on it.
And that's one area UCLA could work on is free throw shooting. They only shoot 64% as a team, but now we're going way off the margins just to find something that UCLA didn't do really well today. 10 seconds. Crowd's already moving on. They've already counted this one. UCLA will stay in the top 10. They beat Oregon State on Thursday night by 12. Going to hammer Oregon today by 30 right now with Elise Ironmonger at the free throw line.
So, Jim, for the second straight week, we said we didn't see this coming, and I think the message is we need to start seeing this coming. This UCLA team is for real.
Yeah, I think we're a little late to the party. Remember last year, 25-9. Well, the Bruins are 15-1 and 5-0 in the Pac-10. Nikki Caldwell's got a pretty good team. For Paul Westhead and the Ducks, they fall to 11-6, 2-4 in the Pac-10. They've got some work. We'll see them against Oregon State at home at the new Matthew Knight Arena on Sunday. Lots of smiles for the Bruins. You expect that? UCLA is now 5-0 in the Pac-10, keeping pace with Stanford. And really, at this point, UCLA is in first place because Stanford is a couple of games behind. And UCLA has a better overall record than Stanford.
They do, and I don't know. You know, we've talked about UCLA not being sure. I'm sure. UCLA has truly made a believer out of me. So I know that everyone else in the nation has to watch out. This team is serious. The defense is super effective, and they've showed that again today.
Nikki Caldwell talked with Mary Murphy at halftime, and those two are back together again.
Markel, tough practice for you yesterday. Your coach pulls you from the starting lineup, and you come out and play a great game. How did you react to not starting?
I just stick to what I have to offer to this team and just bring it every time. Starting or not starting, I still got to bring my game.
14 points, 5 rebounds, 4 steals. You guys played great. Did you see this kind of demolition coming on?
I think so. We had a team discussion before when our practice after Oregon State, and I think that now that team meeting helped us come together more.
Great job. I think the Philly folks are proud of you.
Thank you.
Coach, yesterday was a tough practice. A lot of talking, a lot of running. Did you see this coming?
I was hoping that they would make a change because we needed to make one immediately, and the way that we played the other night was not who we are, and today it was. And so I was proud of them for bouncing back from a tough practice. We got some ice baths to make sure they had their legs, and they just played hard today.
What impressed you most? Incredible defense against one of the top scoring teams in the country, or scoring 87 points and shooting the lights out?
Well, I think the most impressive part was that we brought our defensive scheme. I thought that we did a great job of trying to keep the ball out of their point guard hand so their transition game would slow up a little bit because they like to run and gun. I was very pleased with the play of Walker. I thought she really gave us a huge spark off the bench, and our starters did a great job as well.
I don't want to bring your mood down, but your next game is an undefeated Stanford team against you guys Thursday night at Maples. When do you start thinking about that?
Well, you know, mood isn't down. I mean, I'm always up for the challenge. I think this team is up for the challenge. I know that we're going to work diligently at executing our game plan. And Stanford is an unbelievable program. Coach Vanderveer has done an exceptional job. And I just want our team to understand that, you know, when you go into Naples, that you better be ready to bring everything you have. And so everything that we have, we're going to bring it.
From a big picture standpoint, USC that last weekend. This weekend you win two, including in a very impressive performance this afternoon. Do you guys feel like you're doing a better job with the big mark on your back? You move up to 10th in the country.
I think we're understanding that you're going to get everybody's best game. I mean, we were in that situation just a year ago where we were trying to gun for people as well. But I want to keep this team starving. I mean, last year I thought we were hungry, and there's a difference between hungriness and starving. And today we played like we were starving.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Jim, back to you. UCLA team is for real.
That is a Hollywood smile, and UCLA likes TV. Last week against SC, today against Oregon. They are rolling in Westwood. Best start since 1976. The Bruins with 5 players in double figures today, led by Markel Walker with 14 points. Once again, our final score from Poly Pavilion. UCLA beats Oregon by 30. Tune in tomorrow, 5 o'clock Eastern, for more Pac-10 Women's Hoops, Arizona at Arizona State. Check your local listings. For your producer, Eric Billigmeyer, and Lori Brooks, your director, and of course for Mary Murphy and Lisa Leslie, I'm Jim Watson. So long from Westwood, California. We'll see you tomorrow from Tempe, Arizona.